take questions for both coach and for the student athletes.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. You know, a year ago, there were a lot of blinking lights, you know, when you took a look at our team. You know, roster turnover, you lost one of the best quarterbacks in program history, draft picks, you know, losing All-American O-linemen, things like that. Certainly, we had three new play callers on our staff for the team. And then, you know, certainly myself as the head coach for the first time. In this game, ultimately, you know, we're always measured by wins and losses. But there are a lot of things from last year that I'm proud of. You know, and it's these guys are the reason for it. You know, on a team where these guys hadn't experienced a whole lot of loss as a football team in college, you hit a three-game skid, and all of a sudden this team just rallies around itself and rallies around each other and find a way to put together a season we could be proud of and earn a bowl game. You know, in the end, if you look at the last two or three years, you know, our successes or shortcomings in the win-loss column have come down to one-possession games. When you sit back and look at it, I think it forces you in the offseason to really take a hard look in the mirror and look at yourself as a coach, as a staff, and say, what can we do to improve in some of these areas? For us, we've done that. We've worked hard to improve our plans and our processes in various areas, and that's going to make a difference for us. The biggest advantage for us when you look at it from last year to this year is the continuity. We're the only team in the conference to return all 10 assistant coaches who chose to stay here and be a part of this. Our roster has stayed intact this year, and those things are a catalyst for player development. I don't think you can talk about player development without talking about strength and conditioning. A team's culture is created in the weight room. It's created in the off season, and Connor Neighbors and his staff have done a phenomenal job since the day that they took over. We look at everything with all the resources you have in your possession today, with all the data and all the tracking and things that you can do. We sat down and we've worked tirelessly to make changes that are going to work for this team. Starting in February, when we got back in after February signing day, we had a plan that was going to work for this team. We have a young team with a lot of experience, which is something that's a little bit unique. But you go through this all season, through the spring, and I've never been around a better summer than what we've had this year in 8 years of being here. Because of these things, I know our program is on the rise. We are connected as a program. We have players that are ready to grow into their new roles, and we have coaches and staff that has an intense desire to win and play at a high level. So with all those things, I'll open up to any questions.
We'll now take questions for Coach Desermo and the student athletes. For those of you in the room, if you have a question, please raise your hand and wait for a microphone to come to you. Since we are going out live, please state your name and your media affiliation before asking your question. And for those on Zoom, please type your questions into the chat, and I'll read those aloud.
Kevin Foote, Acadiana Advocate. Coach, with the you lost some wide receivers in the portal. You had some that graduated and moving on. With the lack of experience at the wide receiver position, how important, much more important, could the tight end position be in the passing game?
You know, I think the tight end position is always important for us as a team with the style of play that we want to have in the run game and the pass game. But this year, more than ever, you know, I think the known playmakers that you have are critically important. You know, Neil Johnson is one of those guys that's made a lot of plays for us in the pass game throughout his career. You know, in the receiver room, you still got guys like Peter LeBlanc, who's made plays over the course of his career, Jake Bernard, who had a really good year last year, and Lance LeJean, who's kind of emerged as one of those guys for us at the end of last year. Going into a season like that, you count on your known playmakers to go out there and carry the load early while you develop some of the young talent you have. We've got a really good group of young receivers and young tight ends that are going to play a role in that, but certainly the tight end position and Neil and his production and his play, along with the leadership values that he brings to our team, are going to be huge.
Coach, you got a Zoom question. With Ben Woolridge and Chandler Fields missing all the spring, does that make it harder for those guys? And did that create a chance for Zion Chris?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think in every situation you can look at it, you can look at the positives or the negatives. This spring, the positive is that a young quarterback really got a lot of experience and got a lot of play time under his belt and a lot of practice reps. That's something that usually would take two or three springs for him to get that many reps. So for Zion, that was huge for him, and it put him in a position where myself, our staff, and our team knows that if Zion ends up being the guy that's got to play, we're all completely confident that he could go out there and win football games for us. You know, Ben Woolridge has been cleared. He is 100% cleared by the doctors, and physically he is ready to go. So we're going to go out there with him. I know the question is always, it is not an open competition. Ben, it's going to be Ben against really everybody else. You know, Ben won the job in the fire last year. Ben has worked his tail off to get himself cleared and healthy in 8 months post-op surgery. These guys have seen the work that he's put in. They know what he means to this team. And so for a healthy Ben Woolridge that's completely physically and mentally healthy, that'll probably give us the best chance. We've got to get through fall camp. We've got to put him in situations where he's got to go out there and do it every day. The thing that I think was a little bit negative about spring was you were hoping that Chandler and Zion could have battled it out throughout the spring. That's just not the way it happened. So we'll have to create that competition in fall camp and see where Ben is. But, you know, it's a good problem to have when you've got three quarterbacks that you feel confident in and our team feels confident in.
Jackson Kennedy, student prince, could you just describe the rivalry that has really sprung up in the last year in all sports, but especially football with Southern Miss, and how important are those midweek games on national television to you?
You know, the cool thing about Southern Miss is that that rivalry goes back before, you know, most of us in this room were really around, you know, our respective programs. And so just naturally, the fan bases, I mean, it caught fire. You know, for us, I have a ton of respect for their staff. We recruit the same recruiting areas, the same circles. We're familiar with their players. They're familiar with ours. We know each other's staffs. Our players know each other. I think those things create a natural rivalry, you know, especially with, you know, geographically being so close. You know, for me, the thing I like about it, I like the style of football they play. They're disciplined. They play hard. They're tough. And that's who we are, too. So I just think that you've got two programs that there's probably a whole lot more similarities than differences in. And I think for our fan bases, that's easy to get behind. You know, these midweek games, they pose some challenges, you know, in preparation for it. But it's a great experience for our student athletes to be able to be on national television, for us to be able to showcase, you know, our brands individually and collectively as a Sun Belt Conference, and let really the country see the quality product that we're putting on the field. So I think all those things are great. And you know, Southern Miss, that, like I said, that rivalry goes back long before me and you, and that always makes it fun to be able to kind of start it over again.
Same question for KC and for Neil about the rivalry that you've developed.
It's pretty amazing, honestly. Just my first time experiencing it last season, just seeing the atmosphere playing there, it was amazing. Like, blackout, everyone's amazing atmosphere. So it was great to see that. And it brings a certain type of juice. So I'm excited to see that again when they come down here.
Yeah, I'm definitely with KC on. It brings a certain type of juice to our team, knowing that, you know what I'm saying, we're going against a rivalry school. It just makes us want to prepare harder, play a little harder out there on the field, things like that. But, yeah, it's definitely exciting to be a part of an atmosphere like that. And it's definitely exciting to be able to play a great opponent every week.
Hey, Coach, straight ahead, Megan Glover, KATZ in Lafayette. You talked about in the spring how obviously making a different approach calls for better results. Now that we are heading into the fall season, can you talk about maybe some of the strides that you've seen in the offseason? How's made you all better?
Yeah, you know, when you talk about winning one possession games, you go back and you look at the areas that you didn't maybe perform the way you want to. And, you know, offensively, the thing that was kind of glaring to me was touchdown percentage in the red zone. You know, we refer to them as four-point plays because it's a four-point swing between a field goal and a touchdown. You know, one more touchdown instead of a field goal is a difference in the number of those games. Defensively, you look at two-minute defense at the end of the game. We had plenty of opportunities there in those four games to get a stop in 2 minutes. And get the ball back to the offense and either seal the win or go out there and take the win. So you look at those two things and you say, in a league like this, where in the last, you know, 2 years at least, we've played in 18 one-possession games, the margin of victory is really pretty small in most of these games. So you got to go back to the little things and the details that are going to make you better. And it starts as coaches. You have to look at ourselves as coaches and say, is our philosophy in that part of the field, is it what we need? Are we throwing it too much? Are we running it too much on defense? Are we doing too much? Are we doing too little? And you have to really be critical of yourselves, because these guys do the work. That I promise you. And every day they go out there and they do exactly what we ask. So we're going to put it on ourselves as coaches to continue to work on ourselves and work extremely hard in the offseason to make sure we've got a better plan for them so we can go out there. They know the plan, they understand it, and they can execute it. So that was probably the two biggest areas for us, you know, one offense, one defensively. That, in my opinion, if we play a little bit better in those areas, you flip, you know, four games just like that. And the last 3 years, that's really what it's come down to. You know, the one possession games. When you're successful and you find a way to win those games, you have a great year. When you don't, you know, you're sitting back looking at the what ifs.
Hey, Coach Cody Juno, Louisiana Radio. You opened up your statement talking about blinking lights. And looking back at it, maybe one of those a year ago was the offensive line not having gone through spring. The importance of the continuity of having that group and gearing up to come out of the gates, and what it can do, not for just running the football, which is something that your ball club has been known for, but how it can help those quarterbacks as well.
You know, I think continuity is the thing that you probably always undervalue the most. Last year, going into fall camp, four of our five starters on the offensive line were coming off of off-season surgery. They all missed at least some of the spring practices and some of the summer. This year, we've been able to keep that group intact all the way through spring, through the summer. And you feel you're in a totally different spot right now the way you feel with that. Practice matters. I mean, it doesn't matter what anybody tells you. I mean, if it didn't, I mean, we wouldn't spend as much time as we do on it. And I think for our team in particular, they have seen the difference whenever we do have the continuity and we do have those cohesion working together and we've got those guys all working the same direction. When you got one or two out, it does throw things off. And you know, the year-round plan is only as good as the guys who work it. It doesn't matter what plan you put in place. If the players aren't willing to go out there and go work it and do it, then, you know, it doesn't really matter. So for us, that's been huge to be able to keep those guys healthy this year. Our team, the O-line, but just the team in general, has worked incredibly hard this year to stay on the field, to continue to practice, to continue to work together, to build some continuity. And, you know, certainly O-line play affects everything. Definitely the running game, but the pass game as well. You know, when a quarterback is comfortable, he's willing to stand in the pocket a little bit longer to stand in and make the throws down the field, maybe with a hand in his face because he trusts that they're going to take a hit off of him, and he knows that his guys up front are going to handle the pressures and they're going to be able to handle the movements and do those things. So, you know, it's as cliche as it is, it always starts up front on both sides of the ball. And for us, we feel a lot better about where we're at on the offensive line right now, where last year we were trying to find seven guys that we felt were game ready week in and week out. This year you feel like you've got a true two deep plus. So that's a much better spot to be in, but it comes down to the work that those guys have done throughout the course of the year.
Des, to your right over here, Corey Diaz with the Daily Advertiser. Talking with Casey earlier today, he mentioned something about telling the younger guys what it takes to be a starter, everything that he's learned in order to potentially beat him out for his spot. He said that's going to push him to make his better. What do you like about Casey in a leadership role for this team, especially on the defensive side of the ball, but maybe for the entire team? What does he just bring from a leadership standpoint?
You know, I think a lot of this leadership stuff comes pretty natural and pretty easy to Casey, which, you know, obviously that's a blessing. But the thing that I love about him is that he's willing to learn as a leader too. When you talk to him about the things that goes along with leading, and it's, you know, it's always we, us, and ours, you know, and it's always, we're always a part of it and you're always a part of it. He embodies it because, you know, you got a lot of guys that talk a lot. He walks it, you know, he does it every day. And so it's easy to follow a leader that is showing you the way. You know, one of the terms we use all the time is lead from the front. And it means everything that goes with it. You know, you can't stand in the back and point fingers and tell guys what they need to do. You need to be in the front. You need to be in the grind. You need to be telling them what we're going to do. And I think that's what makes a team what it is, when you have leadership that's willing to walk the talk. And I think KC embodies that. And, you know, our leadership on this team has done a phenomenal job this year. It's a lot of guys that are new to our leadership roles, but they've connected with our younger guys. They've connected with the people that are following them, and they've really bought into the idea that it's going to take all of us to go where we want to go. And it's something that's exciting because you see guys growing in multiple roles. A guy like KC and Neil Johnson that we knew were going to play big roles for us on the field, you get to watch the impact that they have throughout the course of the offseason. And I think those are the things that, as a coach, those are meaningful things to get to see, because you know when a team's starting to gel, you can kind of feel it, and it's because of the leadership on the team. Coaches can say it all they want, but these guys have to do it, and they've done a phenomenal job of leading the way.
To the left, Seth Lewis, KATC and Lafayette. For Neil and for Coach, Neil, you were selected first team All Sun Belt. Just what does that mean to you? And then also emerging and having a bigger role, just how much do you look forward to that? And for Coach, obviously you recruited him here. How much have you seen him grow over the years into the role that he's in now?
Yeah, being a leader on the team is definitely something that I didn't take lightly. I've always wanted to do this for the past, maybe, you know what I'm saying, since I've been here, I've always wanted to be a leader on the team. So actually being able to go out there and lead the team and try to lead the team to victory on Saturdays is something definitely that I take pride in, for sure. And the first team all-conference thing is, I wouldn't say that it makes me work any hard. I've always been the type to work hard. It's just, I guess it's just good to say that, you know what I'm saying, that they're seeing the hard work kind of paying off now. So that's pretty much it. It's a lot exciting.
Well, Neil was not a very good player before I found him and got to coach him, so I'll just start with that. You know, when you get to coach guys, a lot of the satisfaction is delayed. You know, it takes time to get what you want. And from the day Neil got here, there was never a doubt how important football was to him. The guy always practiced really hard. He always loved the game. He was always very coachable. He wanted to know the ins and outs of it. I think Neil would be the first one to tell you, you know, I am most proud of how much he's grown as a person, as a human, as a father. You know, he's got a 5-year-old now, and I've seen him grow every step of the way as a father. And as he's matured and as he's grown in those areas, his play has just skyrocketed. You know, we say it all the time, how you do anything is how you do everything, and all of it matters. And Neil, to me, is a prime example of a guy that he figured it all out, and it all matters, and it's all turned into what you see now. It's turned into a guy that's got it buttoned up tight. He's learned to love the weight room. He's learned to love everything that goes with the process, with the grind of playing football, not just playing, not just practicing. He's learned to understand the value of his education. He's going to graduate with a degree in December. You know, to see him grow the way he has, it's something that you're proud of, because everyone comes in at different levels. Some guys come in, man, that you can just let them roll and just let them go. And some guys, you know, they've got to figure it out a little bit. Neil's always been a significant player for us, but his leadership role hasn't grown until he figured those things out, and then consequently his play has gotten better as well.
Got a Zoom question for both Neil and KC. What is it like to play for Coach Dez, for a guy who not that many years ago was playing quarterback for your school?
It's pretty amazing, because Dez is a pretty pure and genuine guy, so it's easy to have him as a leader. So it's been amazing. Like, he, the same way you see him now, the same way we see him, he's just the same person every time.
Yeah, for sure. Having him as my individual coach at first, and then him going to head coach, he's always been the same person to me. He's always been a great person that I can always go to if I ever needed anything, or somebody who was just there to teach me on, you know, like he said, saying, be a better person, be a better father to my daughter. So it's definitely been somebody that has had a very big impact on my life for sure, and I'm glad to have him as my coach.
Emmanuel Pepis, Sunbelt Conference. This is for Neil. Just talking about, and Coach alluded to it a little bit earlier, the ability for guys to step up in larger roles among the pass catchers, tight ends, wide receivers. Just talk about from your vantage point some of the things that you're really excited from that group to really kind of show this year.
We definitely got a lot of dogs in that tight end room this year. It's definitely going to be exciting to go out there on Saturdays to just produce for the team and help the team win. It's always something that I've always wanted to do, and hopefully it just gets bigger than ever than it has been in the past year. So, it's definitely exciting to be able to go out there and know that I'm going to produce for the team.
Any other questions for Coach Desermo or our student athletes? If not, thank you, gentlemen. Good luck to you this season.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Dan.
We'll continue.